I've made 3 videos about 18th century buttons, so it's time I did a buttonhole video to go with them. I'll cover all the methods I use for buttonholes in my own sewing, and I can't guarantee it's all perfectly accurate, but who can? In fact, I guarantee that some of it is absolutely not historically accurate, but it works and they look nice. First, we'll do just a plain regular buttonhole, and a decorative false one, and then a half open, half closed one, and a couple different options for linings. Oh, and if you read the title of this video wrong, I really don't need to hear about it. I've gotten that comment enough already, on many, many sewing posts over the years. And it wasn't even funny the first time. You will need something to mark the buttonholes with, and some sort of cutting tool. More on these later. A measuring tape or ruler, or both. Thread snips, of course. Beeswax. A fine thread for overcasting, preferably silk. And a thicker thread for the actual buttonhole stitches. Silk buttonhole twist is the best thing to use, and I do have a little bit of it, but I am bad at letting myself spend money on thread, and I've only used it on one project so far. But I really should get some more and try to use it more often. I usually use cotton purl, or crochet cotton, which is not very historical, but it works decently and is much cheaper. It has to be the twisted purl stuff, no stranded embroidery floss. Multiple strands will make things bad and lumpy. It may not be the most ideal thing, but in my experience it holds up pretty well to regular wear. I've been using it for most of my buttonholes for years, and they're never the first part to wear out. I've also gotten good results with linen yarn, as long as it's plied and has a decent amount of twist. These buttonholes are linen, and still in good shape even though the button covers and lining on this waistcoat are starting to wear through. And you'll need needles in the right sizes for both of your threads, and probably a thimble. Before we get to sewing the actual buttonholes, we've got to mark them out. And there are a few different ways I go about doing this, depending on what I'm making. Once I've decided on the button size, I like to lay out all my button molds along the front of my garment, or my pattern piece, to see what number of buttons looks nice. This jacket I'm working on will have rather small buttons, so I'm putting 12 down the front. I mark where the top and bottom buttonholes will go, and measure the distance between them, along the curve if there is one. I divide that measurement not by the number of buttons, but by one less, as that is the number of spaces between buttons. These jacket buttons will need to be 3.8 centimeters apart. Owing to the thickness of most pencils, if you were to just mark each increment one at a time and move the ruler along, the measurements would likely become more skewed and inaccurate the further you got. An easier and more precise way to mark them is to cut a narrow strip of paper, a bit longer than the area where the buttons will go, mark the distance between two buttonholes on one end, preferably with a mechanical pencil or something equally fine, then just fold the paper back and forth like an accordion, keeping it to the same measurement. Cut a little bit off the corners like so, and now you've got perfectly spaced notches to mark out the buttonholes with. Alternatively, you can mark the buttonholes out on the pattern piece itself, which is quite convenient and will save time if you're planning on sewing up the pattern multiple times. Though if you want to do a different number of buttons on a later version, you'd have to trace a copy of the front edge and redo this. The next time I sew this up, I want slightly larger buttons than I used on the first jacket, so I'm only marking 11 buttonholes, this time 4.2 centimeters apart. I use a mechanical pencil so the width of the lines won't affect the spacing too much. I like to punch little holes in the ends of the buttonholes with my pattern notcher, so I can draw dots through all of those and connect them with a ruler. Getting back to the folded paper strip method, I'm marking these 1.3 centimeters in from the edge. The buttonholes should be lined up with the cross grain of the fabric, and it's helpful to have a clear grid ruler to make sure they're all parallel to each other. I'm making these ones 4.5 centimeters, which is much too long for these little buttons, but they'll only be half open. You might find it beneficial to add another line to each side, to indicate how wide to make the buttonhole. I'm marking these ones with a regular pencil crayon because the fabric marking pencils I have are much softer and not as good for fine lines. Sometimes I also use a watercolor pencil. For light colored fabrics, I usually use graphite pencil, and mechanical pencils are really nice if the fabric is smooth enough. Ink is also an option, but if you're going to use ink on tailored things, it has to be waterproof. There are waterproof drawing pens available. You don't want it bleeding all over the place if it gets a bit damp. I will also use washable markers sometimes, but only on things that are going to get washed a lot, so stuff like shirts and nightgowns. Once the buttonholes are all marked out, it's advisable to baste around them. Sometimes I baste around each one individually, and sometimes I just do one row of basting along the ends, depending on the material and how much I expect the layers to shift. I always do a little running stitch, or perhaps a running back stitch, around the holes before cutting them out. It helps hold the layers together and acts as a guide for the buttonhole stitches. I use fine silk thread for this, and I usually wax it, but as you can see from the greasy little spots around the edges of the yellow sample, waxing it is not the best idea if you're working with a light colored silk. To cut them, I usually use a buttonhole chisel. These are pretty easy to find, though the modern ones are quite small and I often have to make at least two cuts for my buttonholes. I'm using a cutting mat in some of these shots, but it turns out that's actually a pretty terrible surface for cutting straight down on. Glossy magazines work much, much better. You can try woodworking chisels too. They're not quite the same because they're only tapered on one side instead of both, but it doesn't seem to make a difference in the cut, and they come in a lot more sizes. If pushing with your hand won't cut through all the way, you can hit the handle with a rubber mallet. Buttonhole scissors are also something that you can get. Mine are not in the best shape and I only use them for machine sewn buttonholes, but they would work for hand sewn ones too if they were sharper. I would use them more if they had a longer gap, but most of my buttonholes are too far back from the edge. And sometimes, if I'm working with a very loosely woven material, I can stick the end of my thread snips through and just cut them open that way. If you're one of those people who uses a seam ripper to open buttonholes, do you also slice bread with a chainsaw? Stop doing that, please. Your projects deserve better, and even the smallest, cheapest little buttonhole cutter is a huge upgrade from this. Just don't. Don't. Stop it. That's not what this is for. Now it's time to overcast the edges, which keeps the fraying threads contained. Just whip stitch around those cut edges with more of the fine thread. If you do the cutting right after you sew around each buttonhole, then you can use the same thread without having to tie it off. This is the point at which I like to mark the locations of the buttons through the holes. That way the buttonhole thread won't get in the way, and won't get any of the marking material on it. If you're worried that the holes might not be long enough, this is also a good time to stick the buttons through them to make sure they fit. Now for the actual buttonhole stitches. Depending on the size of the buttonhole, I usually cut my thread as long as one outstretched arm, or a bit longer. I mark the length of the first buttonhole thread I use on the edge of my table, and after I've sewn it, I'll move the mark if it needs to be a bit longer or shorter. And then I can easily cut all my threads to the right length for that size of buttonhole. You do not want to wax the entire buttonhole thread, because that would make it sticky and less nice looking, but I do wax the first couple of centimeters on the very end so that it sticks in the fabric better. After burying that end in between the layers, I do a couple of stab stitches or back stitches, so the thread is securely anchored without having to tie a knot anywhere. The way I prefer to make my buttonhole stitches is to put the needle halfway through, take the two ends of the thread that are already in my hand, and loop them up and around like so. There are other ways to do it though, so I'll link some more videos in the description. The needle should be going straight up through all the layers, if possible, but mine often end up going through at a bit of an angle, on heavier fabrics or near the ends of the buttonhole. I work my stitches left to right, but if you're left-handed, I assume it would be easier to do it the opposite way. Here's a mirrored shot, if that helps. On some projects, I find I can tighten the thread all the way just by pulling on the length of the thread, and sometimes I grab the thread closer to the knot and wiggle it into place. The knot should be on top of the cut edge rather than in front of it, because if it's in front, then it'll add width and won't look as nice. If your material is not very stiff, you'll have to pull more gently to avoid scrunching it up. 18th century buttonholes are usually quite thin, but not always, and the size and neatness of the stitches varies a great deal. Some of them are very tight and even, and some are a bit more widely and unevenly spaced. I'm doing this first buttonhole without bar tacks, but the vast majority of buttonholes I've seen do have bar tacks on the end, which I'll do on the next one. But for the simplest, most basic buttonhole, once you get to the end of the first side, you just turn around and start working back down the other side. Don't fan out the stitches. The ends should be straight and rectangular. Once all the buttonhole stitches are done, I like to go back through that knot in the very first stitch to connect the ends together. I bring the thread down to the underside, and instead of tying it off, I add some more wax to those last few centimeters, and then I bury it under one of the sides of the buttonhole. Generally, I'm a big fan of tying off my sewing thread securely with a couple of knots, but I always finish my buttonholes this way, and I've never had any problems with it. Unless your buttonholes are very small and practical, you will probably want to add bar tacks. To do that, once you get to the first end, make a few stitches across it. They should be the full width of the finished buttonhole. I usually do 2 or 3, depending on how thick my thread is. Now your thread should be right at the corner of the row of buttonhole stitches you just finished. Sew buttonhole stitches around this little clump of threads. I like to make sure I catch just a teeny bit of the fabric underneath, and this is very awkward to do when the piece is flat, so I fold it to allow my needle to more easily snag just a few threads of the fabric. Just a tiny bit, not enough to make it pucker when you smooth it back out again. This also makes the bar tacks much easier to sew when you're working on something with very long buttonholes and you can't fit your hand all the way around when they're that far in from the edge. You might not want to catch a bit of the fabric under the bar tack though, if you're working with something loosely woven that pulls easily. After finishing the bar tack, I do a stab stitch straight down, so that the little corner doesn't get pulled out of shape when we start the next row of stitches. And once you get back to the other end, do the same thing again. And I finish it off in the same way, by carefully waxing it as close to the fabric as I can, and burying it under the other buttonhole stitches. The bar tacks are worth the extra bit of effort. They make things look so much neater, and they reinforce the ends. As far as I can remember, all the ones without bar tacks that I've seen have been very small, and from the last 2 decades of the century. But of course there are countless garments I have not seen good close-ups of. For short buttonholes I use only 1 length of thread, but for anything longer than about 4 centimeters I use 2. The first thread will be for the first side and bar tack, and the second for the remaining side and bar tack. I do this both because the longer your thread is, the more of a hassle it is to work with, but also because that thread will get scruffier the more times it goes through the fabric. That's true whether you're using cotton purl or silk twist. The end will simply not be in very nice shape after sewing 5 centimeters of buttonhole stitches, though it depends a bit on what you're sewing through. If you go to make a stitch and, oh no, you missed the needle entirely, don't worry. You can still catch that loop of thread on the needle and make the stitch. Make sure it's looped off to the side like this and come at it from underneath, like so. If you run out of thread, you can carefully add a new piece in by bringing the thread down through the buttonhole and making a stitch on the underside, but not pulling the loop all the way closed. Then starting a new thread from the bottom, coming up through the loop, and continuing the stitches as usual. I know I just said that you should not wax your buttonhole thread, but if you're using linen then it's best to wax it just a little bit. Just enough to smooth out the fibers on the surface so that it doesn't shred and get all mangled and fuzzy, or at least so that it does that more slowly. So that's a basic functional buttonhole, but if you're doing 18th century tailoring, there's a good chance you'll need to do at least a few decorative false ones. They were everywhere, and the earlier in the century you go, the more of them there are. On cuffs, on pocket flaps, along the center back vent, and often along a large portion of the front edge of the coat. My 1730s coat has 79 buttonholes, and only 6 of them are functional. Sewing false buttonholes is pretty easy. It's just like the functional ones, but without the cutting or overcasting. I would still recommend doing the initial running stitch to hold the layers together, though. Then just do the buttonhole stitches right on the surface of the fabric. There can be a tendency for the buckram to fold up underneath the stitching, and then your buttonhole gradually gets wider when you don't want it to, so I keep pulling it flat to make sure the width is even. And do bar tacks at each end, just like before. The second row of stitches should be as close as possible to the first ones. I always run my nail along the finished buttonhole to make sure the stitches are lined up evenly and there aren't any gaps between the two ridges. Another thing you can do, for a bit more bulk and stability, is to lay down a heavy thread or cord before starting the buttonhole stitching. For this, I do recommend tying off the ends. Unfortunately, the linen I used here was not thick enough to make a visible difference in this buttonhole, but you get the idea. Very small buttons and very long buttonholes were fashionable for much of the 18th century. And it's not as secure if you have a huge buttonhole to fasten a very small button, so quite often they would do ones that were only partially open, so you'd get the look of a long buttonhole but with the functionality of a short one. If you've already done both of the preceding buttonholes, then this one isn't any more difficult. You mark and outline it in the same way, and then just cut an overcast part of it, and sew the buttonhole stitches along the entire length of it. Your stitches will probably look a bit different at the point where it switches from open to closed, but that's perfectly fine. They do on extant garments too. It makes them very easy to spot in photos. I added a much thicker cotton cord to one of these samples, and as you can see, it made the ridges stand up a bit higher. Now, linings. With modern buttonholes, we're used to finishing the whole garment first and then sewing the buttonholes through all the layers, and they did do that on a lot of things in the 18th century, but not on everything. Sometimes they would sew buttonholes before adding the lining, and there are a couple of different ways of dealing with this. One way is to sew down the lining as you normally would, over top of the finished buttonholes, then cut slits through it and secure the cut edges with large whip stitches. You can stick the buttonhole chisel down through the buttonholes and cut the lining that way, but I prefer to stick a large pin down through each end, and then cut between the two resulting holes with my thread snips. On a few previous projects, I've tried this with a lining that was rather prone to fraying, and so I turned the edges under and sewed them down with smaller stitches, but that leaves the back of the buttonhole stitches exposed and completely defeats the purpose. The ones on my Werther's wrapper waistcoat look especially bad because I used a cotton sateen that frayed terribly, so I think if you're going to do this, you just need to make sure to use a lining that doesn't fray too much. The burgundy glazed cotton I used for this jacket held together nicely, and a lot of silk taffetas are good at not fraying. Some of them do fray easily though, so choose carefully. The other way to do it is to piece the lining in around all the holes, which is more time consuming, but so nice and clean and beautiful. For this one, it's helpful if you've marked out the buttonholes on your pattern, but not absolutely necessary. Cut into the edge of the lining, a little lower than the top buttonhole and a little higher than the bottom one. Baste and sew the rest of the lining in as you normally would. Cut enough little rectangular pieces to fit in between all the functional buttonholes. You can make them a bit too long and then trim them down later. Fold in three of the edges and whip stitch them down as you go, attaching each new piece to the edges of the previous one on either end of the buttonhole. The long front edge of the lining then gets folded under and sewn down with a spaced back stitch. I don't know why they've left this little flap, but it's like that on all four of the extant examples I've seen pictures of. I'm also not sure why they tapered off the main piece of lining on this one, but I have seen another example of that too. You can do the same thing on those earlier styles of pocket flap that button closed at the corners. For this one, I just made a copy of my pocket flap pattern piece, and cut it along the buttonholes to use for the lining pattern. It's hard to get a broad idea of which lining technique was most appropriate for what, because most of the time museums don't post photos of the insides of garments. But from what I've seen, and just from common sense, I'm pretty sure you'd always want to finish it first and then do the buttonholes through all the layers with any kind of washable linen thing, and on breeches. And probably on late 18th century waistcoats with a lot of very short buttonholes. I think the only things I've seen where the lining was added afterwards are coats and waistcoats, usually with long buttonholes. But again, the photos I've seen in books and on the internet are just a tiny fraction of what's out there. The amount of time and effort I'm willing to put into a garment varies from project to project, and often depends on how nice the fabric is, or how much wear I expect it to get. So when I do the buttonholes for my everyday shirts and pants, I usually sew a machine buttonhole with my buttonholer attachment, and then I'll cut them open and do buttonhole stitches by hand on top of that. This speeds things up a bit, and it adds more bulk and stability, which is especially good on things that are just a couple of layers of lightweight fabric. And I'm not going to call it cheating, it's not a contest, you're not married to your thimble, it's just a nice little shortcut. I will also sometimes go around once or twice with regular machine stitching instead of a running stitch before cutting out, and then I'll do the rest by hand as usual. This doesn't save a huge amount of time, but I find it does give you a sturdier base to sew on if you're working with a particularly soft or loosely woven fabric, like these linen pants. I know I did keyhole shaped ones in my previous video, but I didn't cover them here because as far as I'm aware they didn't start appearing until the early 19th century, and this is an 18th century buttonhole video. Another thing I didn't cover at all is metallic buttonholes, which were very fashionable in the first half of the century, and I really do want to get into them at some point because they're so cool and so shiny, and there are multiple different ways of making them. Right now I've only done a few samples and I haven't used them on a garment yet, but someday. I've also never tried 18th century bound buttonholes, but they were a thing. Not very common though, I've only seen them on leather breeches and one single 1780s coat. I'll link those in the blog post. They look a lot simpler than modern bound buttonholes. Okay, I hope this was helpful, and I hope your buttonholes turn out nice. This is absolutely not the only way to make them, it's just the way I like to do them. I'll link some other buttonhole videos in the description. It's good to try a few different methods and see which ones work best for you. It seems like most people prefer to loop their buttonhole thread around from the other end and in the other direction from how I do it, and personally I find that slightly more awkward, but you might not, so try both. The resulting stitch is the same either way. Your first ever hand-sewn buttonhole will probably not be great, but your 50th should be a lot better, and your 100th even better than that. And it's okay if you have to do multiple samples before you're confident enough to do them on an actual garment. Sewing ugly garbage is the first step on the road to sewing beautiful things, and if they are a bit wonky on the garment, that's okay too, and there is plenty of wonky stitching on extant garments. Not okay for me though, I need to judge my own work 100 times more harshly than everyone else's. Bye.